Hey YouTube, this is Lucy from KBeautyHobbit.com. Today's video is going to be a little bit different. I typically do content around skincare, Korean and Asian beauty, tips and tricks and empties videos and things like that. But recently I released a video about my experience with Jamberry, MLM, and how that was pretty messed up and different lessons I learned and why I quit. And that video was fairly popular and got some interest. And I thought back on the reasons why I didn't lose a ton of money with Jamberry and why I didn't have any illusions of grandeur of ruling the world with Jamberry. And the reason for that is because before Jamberry, I was in another MLM. That's what this video is about. The first MLM out of the two that I've ever joined was Mary Kay, and it was a complete and total disaster. So today I'm going to talk to you about how I got sucked into it, my experience, some things that I found very odd, and then ultimately the reasons I quit, and then what happened afterwards. So stay tuned. If you're a current consultant, representative, whatever you want to call yourself for an MLM, this video is not to bash you. That is not the purpose of this whatsoever. There are many wonderful people that do all kinds of different jobs. There are people who are great at it and there are people who are not. In general, I am not a fan of the multi-level marketing industry, and I'm going to tell you just my experience. This is definitely for entertainment purposes only. This is nothing anywhere close to being legal advice. This is just what happened to me a few years ago. Let's start with how I joined. About 10 years ago, I worked for a very large national retail bank with very, very high sales quotas. And I was a banker. I had various customers and good business relationships with a lot of them. One of the people I worked with joined Mary Kay and she was super, super excited. She just seemed thrilled about it. She spoke so highly of it. I did not join under her, but I still kind of saw her excitement and I even bought quite a few different products for her. I was getting married and I wanted to just spoil myself a little bit and get some new makeup, so I purchased things from her. Unrelated to that, I had a customer who sold Mary Kay, and she was a wonderful person, very intelligent, with a similar education to myself. She worked in finance, although not in banking, and she was a great person to talk to. So one day, she tells me, hey, why don't you come with me to this networking opportunity. It is going to be a Mary Kay event and you're going to come and there are all these people who sell Mary Kay and they probably will want business accounts, so you can come and you can network and you can gain business and you can open some accounts and get new customers. So I'm thinking, cha-ching, this is amazing for my main banking job. I'm going to go to this event, I'm going to meet some people, I'm going to tell them about our bank services, and I'm going to sign up for account. I'm going to sign them up for accounts, and this is going to be great. It's going to look really good for my main job, for my performance, and so on. What that event ended up being is this huge Mary Kay, sort of like awards celebrations. There were lots of different units from our area, so lots of different, I think they're called NSDs, National Sales Directors, with all of their downlines, and they just praised themselves, and this is so amazing, and this opportunity is so fantastic. My contact introduced me to her director, and they were just talking about how amazing Mary Kay is, how amazing Mary Kay is, and this is why everybody should join, and the whole event, there were people on stage, and doing awards and talking about all the trips that they've earned and everything else and everything else. You can probably see where this is going, right? If you've ever watched an anti-MLM video. Did I make a single business contact in terms of banking? No. Did I get a single lead? No. Was anybody even remotely interested? No. Did they try to recruit me? Yes. Did it work? Yes. Yes, it did. It absolutely blew my mind. It looked so amazing. I mean, I'd like to say I was young and naive, but I really wasn't that young. I think I was 10 years ago, almost 21, so I guess sort of young, but I should have really known better. I did not sign up on the spot, but it really put a bug in my ear, and I was considering it, and I thought about it and I thought about it and I thought about it and I debated, debated a bit. And then I thought, okay, what's the worst that can happen? I will try it. This person that was introducing me to it, who signed me up, she kept saying how the commission rate was the highest in the business. It was 50%, and how she sold like $15,000 of product a year. And I said, well, what's your profit then? She goes, well, half is my profit. I sold $15,000, so half is my profit. And all these things, and her upline was just oh so nice and oh so encouraging. Oh, you're going to be great at that. You're already in sales. You do sales for the bank, but you don't make anything for yourself from that, which is not true. Made sales bonuses and quotas, and I got paid for every minute I was on the clock because I was hourly. So no, that wasn't true that I didn't make anything for myself. What was true is I wasn't necessarily super passionate about banking products, but I always liked makeup and always liked skincare, which is why I have this channel now. So I thought, okay, well, I will sell something that I actually really, really like, and that should go really well for me. So I signed up. My friend slash acquaintance, now upline, came over to help me that first day, and oh my goodness, that's where the pushing started. So, oh, there's a Mary Kay credit card you can put inventory on. Oh, by the way, you get such fantastic discounts, and you only get them when you're brand new. And if you buy $800 worth of things now, oh, you get these for free, and this for free, and this for free. And if you buy this much, you get this for free, and you should buy. Oh, and you want to have some product on hand. Granted, before you sign up, they tell you, oh, you're not required to have inventory. You're not required. Oh, no. Okay, yeah, you are kind of required, or definitely very much encouraged, because customers are not going to want to wait for orders. You know, they're going to want to have stuff now. So you better have stuff on hand. Well, I'm not a Target, right? I'm not a Walmart. I'm not a Sephora. I don't have the market data to try and predict the inventory levels, which even those huge stores can't always predict them, right? That's why there are all these mega sales happening, right? So I have no idea what kind of colors that I need to buy, what I need to stock, what people might want to like. And keep in mind, this is my like day one in the business. How would I freaking know, excuse me, what sort of things my customers would want? Maybe a consultant who's been doing it for 5 years will know, okay, people kind of tend to like these glosses and these mascaras, and maybe I want to keep this kind of thing on hand. As a brand new person, you have no idea. And the target demographic, or the demographic that your upline sells to, is not going to be the same one as what you at 20 years old are going to be able to sell to. Which brings me to all the weird and deceptive stuff that happened. Number one super deceptive thing was that whole event. Right, that whole thing that got me interested and then eventually got me to join was, come over here, spend your time, spend your free evening here, not getting paid, listen to us sell you stuff under the pretenses that you are going to get some business accounts out of it. Nope, never happened. Number two is the whole, you don't need to carry inventory. Oh, but by the way, we're going to push super hard on you to get inventory, because we make money off of every order that you make. And I don't know about how it is now, but at the time with Mary Kay, all that Mary Kay as a company cared for is what you as a consultant purchased. So once I purchase something, once I spend $400, $800, whatever dollars, my upline gets paid, their upline gets paid, and nobody tracks what you do with that crap afterwards. You don't have to sell it to an end consumer. You are an end consumer, pretty much, as a consultant. And if you're stuck with that inventory, you're stuck with that inventory. Mary Kay does have a buyback program where if you just completely don't want to sell it anymore, they will buy back your stuff at a certain percentage. I think it was something like 90%. They'll give you 90% of your money back, and then you can never be a consultant again. So they do have that option. I don't know how hard it would be to actually use it. I did not use that option, but just in the spirit of fairness, I'm putting it out there, because I know somebody in the comments will say that. But anyway, I just found that deceptive. Then, a super strange thing. So, you are a little person on the bottom of this pyramid-shaped structure. You are a new consultant. And they tell you, you get all this training. Oh, you get all this amazing Mary Kay training. There's Mary Kay University or something like that, that you could watch the videos, which I did. I read the Mary Kay Ash biography, which came in my starter kit. And then our specific unit, and I think this is completely up to each individual unit what they do, but our specific little unit had weekly, monthly, they had some sort of regular meetings where they rented a hotel conference room, and you go there and basically get taught how to sell or get encouraged, praised, or potentially talked down because you didn't do well enough, whatever. I didn't see much of that in our unit, but think about it. The sales director, who's at the top of our little unit, she's getting all her little downline together to encourage them to sell, right? And everything we sell, she makes money on. Here's the weird thing. We had to pay part of the room fee. If you wanted to come to these meetings, which were strongly encouraged that you come, you had to pay money to cover the room rental fee. Like, I'm sorry, what? The sales director's big push was how much money she makes. That was her huge selling point for getting me to join, is I make so much money, which is a weird thing. That's something that rubs me wrong about most MLMs, is this whole flaunt the lifestyle thing. And 10 years ago, I don't even know if Instagram existed. It probably did, but I didn't use it. Facebook was a thing, but online parties weren't really a thing back then, so it wasn't so bad, but they flaunted it in person for sure. So another weird thing that happened was the sales director, so the top of our little local unit, so my upline's upline, invited me over to her house for lunch. So I'm a 20-year-old person working in a bank all day long and then going to school in the evenings. I am not rich, obviously, right? And she's saying how superbly well off she is, right? She has this Mary Kay pink Cadillac, and look at my huge house. Mary Kay paid for all of that, she said. Those are her exact words. So she invites me to lunch in the middle of my workday to her house to come and talk, and then tells me to bring my lunch with me. Like, now that I think back, and I'm like, seriously? Now that I'm a professional, I have multiple undergrad degrees and an MBA, right? I work with recruiters, the job that I have right now, a recruiter found for me. That recruiter made money off of me, right, when I got hired. Definitely not the same relationship as with an MLM, but a little bit similar. The upline that I met with, she made money off my sales, and the recruiter makes money off your placement. That's fine. That's how they make money. When that recruiter invited me to lunch, he paid. And we had many lunches, many different things over the years. So why wouldn't she feed me lunch? Like, I was 20. Just thinking back at it, it's crazy that I had to bring my freaking sandwich with me to her mansion and then listen about all the money she makes, and she couldn't get me lunch. I mean, something doesn't add up there. The next huge misleading and just downline, right, like, unfair point is the whole, you will make 50% of the price as profit. No, you will not. You will not. I don't know how it is now, but back then, if in a catalog the suggested retail price was $100, what you as a consultant paid for that product is $50. So you bought the product for $50 from Mary Kay, and then you were supposedly able to sell it for $100 to a customer. That is not a 50% profit. That may be a 50% top line. When you're a consultant, you sort of like an independent business owner for tax purposes, right? So that can be your top line, that can be your sales, but then from that has to come out taxes, your business expenses, buying your business cards, you had to pay for all of that. Samples, you had to buy all your own products to use and try. If you wanted people to be able to try foundation before they would buy it, which most people are going to want to do because they want to know what their shade is, right? You had to buy all those foundations. You had to buy all the powders. You had to buy everything. You had to buy little single-use mascara wands and all those sorts of things. You had to pay for everything, for catalogs, for everything. So that 50% got eaten up super quickly. And another thing, at the time, Mary Kay, again, I don't know what they do now. And on purpose, I did not go and research what they do now because I didn't want the new information to taint my existing memories of how it was. I really want to focus on what happened to me personally and not what it's like now. But at the time that I did it, hostess rewards were not a thing at Mary Kay. Like Jamberry, for example, the company provided hostess rewards for the hostess. That did not come out of the consultant pocket. But with Mary Kay, if you wanted to offer any sort of hostess reward, that came out of your own pocket. So if you told somebody you're going to get a free lip gloss, you had to buy it. Yes, at 50% off, but you had to buy it and give it to that person. So the company provided absolutely nothing. Let's talk about how I lost money and why I quit. So for all the reasons that I've mentioned of me not being a big box store with its own research team and just not knowing what to stock, I bought all the wrong crap. Nobody wanted the things that I bought. I did sell some of it, and I did have to buy all the powders. I thankfully didn't buy at least the liquid foundations. Those are very, very expensive. I bought all the loose powders. I would haul my little stuff around, and people would try them, and I did make some sales, and then people didn't want to pay full price. People feel like if they know you and your friends that they can get a discount from you. Nobody wanted to pay a full price. Well, any of the discount, that just comes straight out of your so-called 50% profit. So that happened. Nobody wanted to wait on shipping, of course, just like Mary Kay basically warned me. And people typically didn't want the things that I had. It's not like the things that I had were necessarily bad, but when you offer, I can't remember what, but 12 or 15 different lip glosses, the chances of me guessing the correct 5 to buy are fairly low. And as I mentioned before, at the time, online parties and Facebook parties weren't such a huge thing. So you had to do it in person, and that took a lot of time. And it also was pretty deceptive. The big selling point of Mary Kay parties is, oh, you get a facial, a pamper session, a facial. Okay, when I think of a facial, I think of you go to a spa or some sort of salon and you lie down and they steam your face and they do things to it. And I've only had a handful of facials in my life, but they were all like that. It's a luxurious experience, sort of like going to a massage place, and you just relax and people do things to you. A Mary Kay facial, Mary Kay consultant, you don't have to be a cosmetologist, you don't have to be a licensed esthetician, you just have to have a social security number, a pulse, and the ability to either pay or go into debt, and you have to be a certain age. That's it. You don't have to actually have any licenses. So Mary Kay tells you you're not allowed to touch people's faces, you're not allowed to do the facial, which makes sense, but it's super misleading to tell a person, hey, come and get a facial, and when they come, oh yeah, here, you wash your face with this, and here's a little tray with little squeezes of product, and so you wash your face, and now you apply this, now you apply this, now you apply that. Oh, look at you, you got a facial. That is so crappy, and I see people online complaining about that. This happens at bridal shows and different trade events, where you'd have like a drop box for, oh, drop your business card or drop your information and win a facial. And then every single person wins and you get a call, oh, you want a facial for you and a couple of friends. And you show up and it's a freaking Mary Kay thing. I went off on a tangent there, didn't I? My point was that hosting parties in person cost you time and money in snacks and drinks and just arranging things. And people will buy one lip gloss just because they feel obligated, or one little makeup liner, or one little eyeliner, or something like that, just because they feel obligated. And it just never really gave me the income that I was hoping it would give me. I really thought that it could be some sort of supplemental income, and I feel really dumb about it now, thinking about it, knowing what I know about MLMs and knowing what I know just in general about how life works. It just wasn't going to be so easy. People who make it in MLMs, they're really hard workers. People who get to the top, I mean, yep, some of them do it dishonestly, but a lot of them, they're just either they were lucky to join early enough, but most of the time they're in the business of consistently recruiting and training a workforce with really high turnover. And I just wasn't going to do that. I'm not the right person for that. I don't even know how much money I lost. I did not use that buyback program from Mary Kay. I sold everything that I could at a discount. I've given some lip glosses and things that could generally be used so not foundations and such, but things that could be used by most people, I gave them away as stocking stuffers or just as gifts to friends or whatever. I actually gave whatever was left of my consultant kit, like the bag and the different little trays for parties and just different supplies like that, the single-use mascara ones, those sort of things, I actually gave them to the person who recruited me. So I got rid of all of that. And the person who recruited me, I think, is a fine person. We don't really have any contact anymore, but she helped me with various job-related things. She was a reference for a couple interviews for me, just because we're in the same field, kind of. We're in the finance field. So I have no hard feelings. I don't know if she ever became a national sales director like she wanted to. I mean, if that was her huge big goal, then hopefully she got there. But I'm not sure, to be honest. The really unsettling, annoying thing that happened was every so often her upline, so that pink Cadillac, come to my house but bring your own lunch person, that person would call me and email me and text me about joining again. And I've told her no in polite but not uncertain terms many times. And it got to a point where I seriously had to block her. And I don't block people very often in terms of like personal cell phone contacts. If you are somebody who has my phone number, chances are we had some kind of relationship, professional or friendship or whatever. So it takes a lot for me to block a person, but I blocked her because it just got ridiculous. She just would not take no for an answer. And I knew she was just short a recruit that month or whatever. You're just a number at that point. That was my experience with Mary Kay. Thankfully, I did not lose a ton of money. Thankfully, I did not go deeply into debt. I do think it's a little fuzzy now, but I feel like I did open that Mary Kay credit card. I feel like that actually happened. I'm not sure anymore. It's been almost a decade. And we've been a Dave Ramsey family for years. We don't do any sort of credit cards anymore, so it's not an issue. But I'm just happy that I was able to put that behind me and come out of that without thousands of dollars in debt and thousands of dollars in useless inventory. But it still irks me when I see dishonest reps online trying to do these thin-veiled advertisements for their business and say that they get free cars. You don't. You get an allowance toward a lease, and you have to meet your sales goals and your recruitment goals to maintain that. That is way different than a free car. A free car is a car you could sell. If you quit the job immediately, if you quit being a consultant immediately, that car would still be yours. You would have the title. That is a free car. A car that you have to bust your butt off for, recruiting, selling, deceiving people, doing all those things just to get an allowance toward a lease that is in your name and that you're responsible for, that's not a free car. And that's the case with so many MLM claims. They will say one thing, but it's really not true. And my personal favorite thing, and this is fresh in my mind because just this week I accidentally got into it with a Mary Kay consultant online, which I try not to get into arguments with strangers on the internet, but sometimes against my better judgment, it just happens. And this person seriously said that nobody gets a free car who's not an MLM. I'm like, are you serious? Like, we have a company car for my husband parked right outside right now. Oh, by the way, it's not a lease in his name. And by the way, he doesn't have to recruit a certain amount of IT people to keep his car. You know, he doesn't have to sell a certain amount of IT services to keep his freaking car. And he gets a gas card and they pay for repairs. Like, what? And then she said, oh, well, good for him, but it's hard for a lot of people to get, especially women. Seriously, lady? Like, are you that out of touch with reality? People who bash the corporate world, which is largely the MLM community that just loves to bash on corporate jobs. I mean, seriously, have you guys ever worked a corporate job? A good corporate job where education is required and skill and experience, where your employer values you, you get lots of cool perks and you get paid well for your time. Oh, but it's so hard to balance work and family when you're a mom and blah, blah, blah. I'm a mom. I'm in corporate world. I work 25 hours a week. My employer was superbly understanding when I asked for that arrangement when I was pregnant with my second child, because I have the education and the skill and the experience, and I bring value to the company, and they appreciate that and they understand that. So we made a deal with them. We made an arrangement that works for everybody. So stop with your crap. Being an MLM consultant and losing money is not the only way to be there for your family. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with working full-time and being a mom. A lot of people don't have a choice. A lot of us, we can't stay home, or we don't want to, which is also, by the way, fine. There's nothing wrong with wanting to work and wanting to use your education and wanting to work. Just, okay, this is really going off on a tangent. I'm starting to sound like some of those other anti-MLM videos that I watch online, which I love, by the way. I love it. So, I hope this was entertaining, and I hope that you learned something useful for yourself. If you had any experience with MLM, good or bad, let me know. I know that not all the products are crap, there are plenty of good MLM products, but the structure itself is kind of set up to fail, or it sets you up to fail as a consultant. So I hope you're having a wonderful, wonderful week. I will see you in my next video, which will not be about MLMs. I think this is my last one. So until then, please remember to always listen to your skin. Thank you so much. Bye.